I ever thought I'd like to invite you to the First Baptist Church. Delighted that you're here this morning as we gather together to worship and song and open God's Word. We're going to begin with a video announcement about the ladies' ministry that's coming up next week. Something that's great. It'll be an event for you. Let's warm up together. Fellas, we're not invited, but that's a great opportunity for you to be together. It's just like being perfect. The fellowship days and the time in God's Word. Also, next Sunday, let me remind you, it's an important day in the life of First Baptist Church. The schedule will be a little different. Next Sunday will be our dedication service. If you haven't noticed, the construction project is functionally over. In the spring, there'll be a few things that we need to do on the outside, but we are praising God for the completion of the building construction project. And we look forward to dedicating so don't worry about talking to Andy, who is scheduled to have a speaking tube inserted into his directly for his stomach. And that would be a preparation for him to come home sooner. But if there's some particular grief for the Andy family, if he does, I also want to continue to pray for the right family, say the one that's brother. I want to put him to be with the Lord, and his family was Friday. We've also announced that the 14-year-old girl that we have been praying for, who had the request of her right home, to be with the Lord last week. James writes this in the letter of James, chapter 1. Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect and complete. Sometimes it's easy to read it in verse of scripture and say, yeah, that's what we're supposed to do. And there are times when God causes his children to walk in very, very difficult. Sometimes think about why we gather as a local church. What's the point? Why are we here? Because we need to be men and women who are growing in our walk with the Lord. We need to be men and women who are maturing in our faith. As many of you perhaps have already read some of these things, but I just want to, as a means of encouragement, share what Satan said. This is from a father of a 13-year-old. Our way is safely home. God gave her to us for a little while, a daughter in Adam's flesh. He has taken her to himself, his daughter in Christ. We carried her for a time, but now she is with him. I can only imagine what a father feels when he walks his daughter down the aisle, walks her down to give her away to another man, to her grandmother. I had expected to one day give my one over to a man. I imagined apprehension over wondering if I could trust him with my daughter, if he was worthy. We walk with our word as far as we are able. And now she's with the bridegroom. We can trust both to him. He is more than worthy. His word has made possible her righteousness before the Father. Perhaps you are familiar with this kind of overwhelming sorrow. were in earshot of the messenger. And I'm sure that was touching to hear their voices as they worked together in prayer. One last thing. From John 2:7, there's an amazing one. The guys who worked for me got the brain that laid blocks for the moment yesterday. When I instructed them on how to proceed, I said that it would be part of the beginning, since we are in the dry season, and the rain is so hard. Their response was, this is a symptom, and our tears will soften the rain. And they were done. Son Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for the fact that you are willing to send me your very best to planet Earth, where he lived a perfect life, so that he could be the spotless Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Thank you, Father, that you were pleased to raise him from the dead on the third day. And now those of us who put our faith and trust in Christ in his righteousness. Now, when we hear the sad story of a 14-year-old girl who has passed away because she knows Jesus as her Savior, Seth Godin can write about surpassing joy of knowing that this is not the end, of knowing that she has been completely healed. To pray for those who are serving their people, even today, as the funeral service is even happening and has happened. Thank you for being the God of all comfort. Thank you for your grace, which you promise is sufficient. Lord, encourage our hearts with the words of this testimony. Father, give us the desire to truly be men and women who know you. Just when things are good, when things are difficult as well, we want to be able to say your name. We want to be able to say that our faith in you doesn't waver, no matter what. Lord, if there are some of us that we mentioned continue to stand on the field and are touched from you, grateful for your presence and your ministry in our lives, what we pray especially this morning. Pray for the prophet. Father, we ask that the prophet that we can enable him to leave the hospital soon, and soon he would be able to take nourishment with him in his normal manner. For God, the Lord Jesus, Father, long and firm, we commit him to you, asking that your will be done by others more than stand. Sign of the cross, not our lips, To look at verses 28 through 38 this morning, or when I get the title of this morning's message, is of God. Acts chapter 20, beginning with verse 28, the Bible says this: Be on guard for yourselves and for the flock, upon which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. I know that after my departure, seven dwellings will come in among you. Not sparing the flock. It's from among your own selves, men will arise, speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after them. Therefore, be on the alert. Remember that night and day for a period of 3 years I did not cease to admonish each one with fear. And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give yourselves know that these things ministered to my own needs and to the faith of my brethren. In everything I showed you that by working hard in this manner, you must help quit and remember the words of the Lord Jesus that he himself said, it is more blessed to give it than to receive. And when he said these things, he knelt down and prayed with them all. They began to weep aloud, they embraced Paul, and he repeated it this way. Breathing especially over the word which he had spoken, that they would not see his face again, and they were accompanied him to the ship. Now, in context, you should remember that Acts chapter 20 is known as Paul's farewell to the Ephesian elders. Earlier, we read along and studied as the Apostle Paul ministered in Ephesus. We read about that. If I recall, any of that believers there who had only been baptized with John's baptism, he explained that John's baptism was telling the people to believe in him who was coming after the baptism of Jesus. Those believers were then baptized by believers' baptism, and when Paul laid his hands on them, they received the Holy Spirit. As Paul was ministering there in Ephesus, the Bible tells us that all who lived in Asia heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks. You might remember as we were studying Acts 19, the Bible says that the Apostle Paul was performing extraordinary miracles. I settled for just a normal miracle, but Paul was doing extraordinary miracles. You remember his handkerchiefs, which were either sweat clots or his aprons. If they were taken to someone who was sick, the Bible says that a person would be healed. The name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. You might remember we talked about the sons of Sceva. Remember when they tried to use the name of Jesus sort of as a magic formula? You remember the evil spirit did the man who was possessed? Sceva! And he said, I recognize Jesus. I know about Paul. This was a healthy church. We know that the church was growing. In fact, listen to what the Lord Jesus himself says about the church in Ephesus. Jesus, speaking to this church in Revelation chapter 2, says, I know your deeds and your toil and perseverance. And that you cannot tolerate evil men, and that you put to the test those who call themselves apostles if they are not. And you found them to be false. And you have perseverance and have endured for my name's sake and have not grown weary. I think we, at a First Baptist Church, would like to be known that way, wouldn't we? We persevere. And we work hard, we don't get tired. That we can discern between truth and error. Yet as he closes out his words of farewell, he gives the Ephesian elders and the message that the Ephesian elders and the Ephesian church needed to hear, but guess what? It's also a message that we need to hear this morning. On God, being on God. And that's the first point. Be on guard. Now again, context is important. In context, the Apostle Paul is speaking very clearly to the elders of the Church of Ephesus. It's not the whole church. He's speaking to those who are serving in Ephesus. But elders are shepherds. He says to them, be on guard for yourselves and for all the flock, among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to shepherd the Church of God. That's something that we need to understand, that the Lord Jesus himself is the great and the good shepherd. These elders were under shepherds. Another word for elder would easily be pastor. The role of an elder, the role of a pastor in any local church is to lead the flock, feed the flock, guide the flock, train the flock, guard the flock. And you'll notice Acts chapter 20 talks about how someone who serves in the office of elder arrives at that office. They are chosen by God. Be on guard for yourselves and for all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you. Our practice here at First Baptist Church is every year about annual meeting. There are some individuals, there's some men on the ballot who are going to serve as deacon, and there are some men on the ballot who could serve in the office of elder. And you might be thinking, no, we decide who the leaders of First Baptist Church are going to be. No, God. When we vote, all that we are voting on is to confirm what it is we believe God is right. Someone does not become an elder because we put them into office. Someone becomes an elder because the Holy Spirit has raised them up. And all that we do is say, yes, we believe this is what God has done. And notice this. How important is the church? All of us, when we think about this local church, it has a priority in our lives somewhere. It could be a high priority, it could be a low priority, or it could be kind of a low priority. But listen to God's priority for the church. Shepherd the Church of God, which he purchased with his. The Church of Jesus Christ was purchased with his own blood. Therefore, it is of utmost importance. You might say, well, Dr. Steve, that's great. Paul's giving us an address to the elders, but I am not now, nor will I ever be an elder, therefore, it does not apply to me. The application is indeed for all believers, yes. In context, he was speaking to the elders of the church. But you realize that even here at First Baptist, while every elder must shepherd, not every shepherd is an elder. Do you realize that it's very unwise. Remember, we've talked about the idea of discipling other believers. That all of us ought to be thinking about one, we ought to be leading one. Following one, we have to be finding one. You understand that, right? Yes. So I say, if you are leading one, if you are discipling someone, do you know what another word you could use for discipling? Shepherd. Helping that person grow in their walk with the Lord. And by the way, when we look at the qualifications of an elder that we would read about in 1 Timothy chapter 3 and Titus chapter 1. there is a specific qualification that we at First Baptist Church would understand to be that an elder needs to be a medical. Besides that qualification, all of the character qualities are qualities that ought to be evident in the life of every mature man. Can you hear the Apostle Paul saying to the Corinthian church, imitate me, as I am in Christ? Philippians 4:9, the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. In Titus 2, all of the likewise are to be reverent in their behavior, not malicious gossips, or enslaved to much wine, teaching what is good, so that they may encourage the young women to love their husbands, to love their children, to be sensible, pure, workers at home, God, being subject to their own husbands, so that the word of God will not be defiled. So while you could say, I don't hope the office, it still applies to us. Because we're to be concerned about the job. We're to be discipled. We're to be shepherded. Notice what he says first. Be on guard for yourself. The very first thought that Paul has as he says goodbye to these Ephesian elders is watch out for yourself. He says that similarly to the Ephesians where he says, therefore, be careful how you walk, not as wise men, but as wise men. So the Christian believers, he says, do you not know that all those who run the race all run, but only one receives the prize, run in such a way that you may win? Many run. One wins. Run to win. He also says to those same Corinthian believers, therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed that he does. And I wonder, as a follower of the Lord Jesus, am I a believer who lives in such a way that I am being on guard for myself? Or have I suddenly thought I've arrived and I've got it all figured out and I really don't have to worry or think or take concern with my walk with Christ? To the Roman church, Paul wrote, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh. Are we careful to make sure that we're walking in purity? Are we careful to make sure that we are walking in holiness? I can remember when I was a teenager. Pornography was available in Pensacola. Typically, sold in adult bookstores or the drugstore. Right in the corner where the magazine racks were. Now, by the time I was a teenager, there was a covering on the magazine so you couldn't see too much. I wish I could tell you that your pastor only knew what he was talking about because of someone else's experience. But I was a teenager. But you know what I had to do? Do you know what I had to do? When I would go to the drugstore that I knew had those magazines, I would do my very best to avoid that section. You want to know why? Because if I went back there, I would look. Why? Because I wanted to look. Why? Because I'm a sinful guy. I had to be on guard for myself. I had
First Peter chapter 2, abstain from fleshly lusts which wage war against the soul. You realize we have an enemy. We have an enemy that wants to rip us up. We have an enemy who wants us to fail. And so the challenge is to be on guard, first of all, for ourselves. Is that for each celebrity deconversion, there are hundreds of unknown believers who deconvert, but don't get it. Deconversion from Christianity is a growing and troubling trend, and one that the church and Christian Academy cannot ignore. In 2015, the Pew Research Center reported that for every individual who becomes a Christian, four men. Think about that for a minute. A lot of surveys say similar things. But perhaps the most concerning statistic comes from the Clientele Foundation, who in 2018 claimed that over the next 30 years, Christian affiliation in the United States will decline by 1 million. Statistics say whatever you want statistics to say. That's your statement. Is it right or wrong to think about what every year comes through for me? For every kid that we send to college, some of them will somewhere in that process say, for yourself. Do you know what you believe? Do you know why you believe it? Are you teaching it faithfully to your children? Can you say, here I stand, so that when something difficult comes in your life, like the Maui family, they can say, we know who God is, and we know that He's good. We're not going to give up on Him, become bitter, or turn our backs. Verse 29. I know that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. Not only does Paul say be on guard for yourselves, but be on guard against those who are on the outside. Understand this morning, the world is not our friend. A lot of us wish it was. Sometimes we act as if it is, but the world is not our friend. John writing about the world in 1 John 2 talks about all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. And Paul says, watch out, because savage wolves are going to come in. They're going to try to get you. Did you get a picture in your mind's eye of a savage wolf? Here is real. That wolf has one desire, one plan to rip and tear and destroy and kill. Have you thought about that recently? And are we, as followers of the Lord Jesus, on guard, on the defense? Are we ready? Hark at Jesus. reflects this heritage of secularists and other spiritual enemies attack healthy churches. I don't know how you think about the First Baptist Church. I actually think God has been blessing us. I actually think we are relatively healthy. We're going to have a dedicated service saying thank you, God, for an expanded facility. I was excited a little bit. We didn't quite do it because of the snow on Friday, but last week when I read the announcements and I see in the bulletin that every single day of the week there was something going on here, and I said, praise God, that's a good thing. But guess what? You think Satan is looking at First Baptist Church and saying, come on, we don't have to worry about this. Now's the time. Now's the time where I would expect that he's going to up his attack. Because the enemy attacks healthy churches that are weaker or obsolete ones. And I wonder, are we careful? Oh, we're going to go home now this afternoon. And do we just turn on the TV and mindlessly watch what's there? We turn on the radio and mindlessly listen to what the world's got for us. Why don't we watch the news? And look there on the messages. The world is trying to communicate. And are we being careful? Are we being on guard? Are we making sure that we're filtering everything to the pleasantness of what God's word says? But it's worse. Be on guard for yourself. Be on guard against us on the outside. Those first things. From among your own selves, men will arise, speaking perversely to draw away the disciples. We've got to be on guard against those on the inside. We've promoted a new tagline that you can easily say the mission statement at First Baptist Church. Our mission is to glorify God by discipling biblically literate ambassadors of Christ. Discipling biblically literate ambassadors of Christ. Why? Because every believer that comes First Baptist Church needs to be growing in spiritual. If you're the same as we begin 2022, as you were when we began 2021, corporately we have failed. We ought to be good. We ought to be mature. Why is it important for every believer to be biblically literate? So that we all know what God's word is. We ought to be Bereans. Remember who the Bereans were? They would check the scriptures daily to make sure the things that they were being taught were true. I told you when I first started preaching here that I would never know anything you wanted to be. And I think I've kept that promise. It's not checking. Don't just say, well, Dr. Steve said it must be true. It's God's word. Does it match up to what God's word says? And the first time that Dr. Steve or Pastor or so-and-so says something that doesn't match up to God's word, your hand ought to be up and saying, time out! I know what God's word says. Notice what these false teachers will do. From among your own selves, men will arise to begin perverse things to draw away the disciples after them. One of the hallmark characteristics of a false teacher is pride. I want people to follow me. Do you remember? They also say, he loved to be first among them. Romans 16, we read, "As now I urge you, brethren, keep your eye on those who cause dissension and hindrances contrary to the teaching which you learned. Turn away from them." Have you ever known another believer that all that they seem to do is watch the right time? There's always something wrong. There's always a criticism. There's always a problem. Do you know what he said? Do you know what he did? For such men are slaves, not of our Lord Jesus Christ, but of their own appetites, and by their smooth and flattering speech, they deceive the hearts of the unbelievers. You know what else happens? What the Bible says will happen in the church from among our own selves. Paul writing Timothy says, "For the time will come when they will not." We want to be more faithful than we are, and we fail. They will accumulate for themselves teachers and students to work on the subject. They will turn away their ears from the truth. They will give them a sight to face. So be on guard. And by the way, how do you know? How do you know if there's a false teacher or false prophet among us? Jesus teaches you. The Sermon on the Mount says, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits." Grapes are not gathered from thorn bushes, nor figs from thistle planting. So every good tree bears good fruit, but the barren tree bears bad. Someone is teaching. If it doesn't square with the truth of God's word, and there's no evidence of the Holy Spirit working in the life of that individual, I wouldn't give it a second time. Remember, we talked about the fact that every maturing believer has the act of temperance. There's no medical. The act of temperance, prudent, respectful, gentle, peaceable, a good reproach. Having a good reputation with those outside the church. Here's the challenge: be on guard for yourselves, be on guard for the outside world, even be on guard on the inside. Make sure you hear the truth. Nothing but the truth. Those first 32. And now I have you in God. The word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance of all those who are sanctified. The second point, I think the Apostle Paul is telling those Ephesian elders to be bathed in truth. Be bathed in truth. You understand that our spiritual lives ultimately is a work of God. I've been preaching here 9 and a half years. Do you know how many hearts I've changed in 9 and a half years? none. I can't change a single heart. I can't even change my heart. But God can. The psalmist David says, create in me a clean heart. How many of us are crying out, God, I want to be on guard. I want to be faithful. I'm asking you, I want to be faithful. Truth. I love the expectation that the Apostle Paul has, because I don't know about you, but sometimes I get a little discouraged. I'm not who I want to be. I'm not where I think I should be. Or maybe in this local church, you know, we're disappointed because we failed again. Stop it. Because Paul says, I'm confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it. That's what it means to come to. His work, which he started in us, aren't you glad that this is not his business? And he's going to finish the job. And I wonder again, as we relate to each other, First Baptist Church, pray. How do we think about each other? I love the prayer that the Apostle Paul has for the Ephesians in Ephesians 3. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth derives its name, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in the inner man, so that Christ may dwell in your heart through faith. Father, pray for the brothers and sisters of the God that will be watching out for themselves. We'll be holding each other accountable to be faithful to the truth. Father, I pray we would be thinking ourselves in truth. That your Holy Spirit would be strengthening my brothers and sisters in Christ to be free men. So that Christ would be great. To be connected to God, but he also connected them to the word of his grace. The word of his grace. And among the verse that many of us know, the law of scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. How does God do that work in our hearts and lives? The power of his Holy Spirit and the power of his word, not by osmosis. This is the God-breathed word of God. It's his word. It's true. It teaches us. You want to know how we come to get something? Read God's word. How he expects us to treat each other? Read God's word. How to prioritize our lives? Read God's word. How to raise our families? Read God's word. How to conduct our business? Read God's word. He reproves us. I'm not perfect. You might have noticed that. Neither are you. But as we read God's word, we find out, maybe there's some areas that I need to change it. But not only does God's word point out error in our lives, it helps us know how to correct it, find the problem. It gives us opportunities for training in righteousness. Like we're in King's faithfulness, that if we continue doing what it is God's word tells us to do, we become the men and women that he wants us to be, so that the man of God may be adequate. As he wraps up his farewell to the Ephesian elders, finally he reminds them that we have been blessed to give. Blessed to give. Paul says in verse 33, I covet no one's silver or gold or clothes. We covet other people's stuff. You yourselves know that these things It's more blessed to give right when we started thinking about this church, the church of Ephesus. I know your deeds and your toil and your perseverance. This is a church that works hard. I know they work a lot for like 50 years. And I'll bet that there were people that still didn't have a lot of regret almost every year back because we work hard. And we persevered with respect to this church. We stood for the truth. Remember from where you have fallen. Repent and do the deeds you did first. Or else, I am coming to you and will remove your lampstand out of its place. Unless you do. Saints of First Baptist Church, on your Father, thank you this morning for your word. Thank you that the Apostle Paul didn't miss a lot of words as he called the Ephesians, teaching others to be on guard for themselves, to be on guard against those on the outside, to be on guard even against those on the inside who would teach falsely and trust the Bible as well. Thank you, Father, for your word. Thank you that it contains that it calls for the meaning of the word of God, and that you are confessed with sometimes. Accurately to that point where we need to be. Give us the humility to repent when we need to repent. Give us the strength to recognize the areas that you would like to change our hearts and our lives. And Father, we'll be careful to give you the praise and the glory as we seek to obey that greatest command, loving you with all that we have as a neighbor and as a son. So this is what we pray. Your friends will be in the comfort of a few minutes if you'd like to pray for chat. Thanks for being here.